You're gonna have to run the camera too. Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles. They are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, the Greek, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach according to the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes that pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called laws of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Nanette Ramirez that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson today will be Ecclesiastes, the 7th chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good evening, class. Good evening. Let us all bow our hearts and minds in this moment of prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father Yahweh, for allowing us to gather here today so that we may learn of your purpose, pattern, and plan. We ask that you continue to open up our hearts and our minds so that we may gain a profound knowledge of your purpose, pattern, and plan. All this we ask in your Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Look at the Good evening, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Ecclesiastes, the 7th chapter, page 797. And I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. Ecclesiastes, the 7th chapter. A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for that is the end of all men, and the living will lay it to his heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by the sadness of the countenance the heart is made better. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of the fools is in the house of mirth. It is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for a man to hear the song of fools. For as the crackling of the thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fool. This is also is vanity. Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad, and a bribe corrupts the heart. Better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof, and the patience in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. But not hasty in thy spirit to be angry, for anger resteth in the bosom of fools. Say not thou, what is the cause that the former days were better than these? For thou doest not inquire wisely concerning this. Wisdom is good with an inheritance, and by it there is profit in them that see the sun. For wisdom is a defense, and money is a defense, but the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth life to them that have it. Consider the work of Elohim, for who can make that straight which he hath made crooked? In the day of prosperity, but joyful, but in the day of adversity, consider. Elohim also has set the one over against the other, to the end that man should find nothing after him. All things have I seen in the days of my vanity. There is a just man that perisheth in his righteousness, and there is a wicked man that prolongeth his life in his wickedness. But not righteous overmuch, neither make thyself overwise. Why shouldest thou destroy thyself? Be not overmuch wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why shouldest thou die before thy time? It is good that thou shouldest take hold of this. Yea, also from this withdraw not thy hand, for he that feareth Elohim shall come forth of them all. Wisdom strengtheneth the wise more than 10 mighty men which are in the city. For there is not a just man upon earth that doeth good and sinneth not. Also take no heed unto all words that are spoken, lest thou hear thy servant curse thee. For oftentimes also thine own heart knoweth that thou thyself likewise hast cursed others. All this have I proved by wisdom. I said, I will be wise, but it was far from me. That which is far off and exceed deep, who can find it out? I applied my heart to know and to search and to seek out wisdom and the reason of things, and to know the wickedness of folly, even of foolishness and madness. And I find more bitter than death the woman, whose heart is snared in nets, and her hands as bands. Whoso pleadeth Elohim shall escape from her, but the sinner shall be taken by her. Behold, this have I found, said the preacher, counting one by one to find out the account, which yet my soul seeketh, but I find not. One man among a thousand have I found, but a woman among all those have I not found. Lo, this only have I found, that Elohim hath made man upright. but they have sought out many inventions. I have read Ecclesiastes, the 7th chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Ramirez, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. So today is Thursday, and it is our open testimony night. And I would like to open the floor for anybody in here who would like to give a testimony, and also anybody out visiting on us on Zoom. We'd like to welcome you and offer the opportunity to give a testimony as well. So if you'd like to give a testimony on Zoom, unmute yourself and let it be known, or anybody here in class, let me know. Okay, so for our first speaker, I would like to call Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Again, I can say it's a great honor and a pleasure that Yahweh has allowed us all to be here, and I'm going to say especially me, because we never know. You know, as I was speaking to one of the sisters last night, and I find myself more so than ever saying, well, I'm going to do this, or I can do this. And following that is my statement, if Yahweh's willing. You know, because, and I was thinking earlier today, this scripture is really like, wow. But I was thinking today, you know, that people are thinking, you know, when we think of miracles, we think of somebody being greatly healed from a disease or having something to just, you know, your profound that happened and healed. And it was coming across my mind, and I'm always in the dirt, you know, like I was doing my garden, starting to cultivate and even plant and pull weeds. And that is my time that, you know, Yahweh just be loud and clear. And it was like the miracle is the fact that we go through miracles all day long, every day. You know, we talk about, you know, the death, burial, and resurrection when we go to sleep, when we wake up. You know, that is a miracle within itself. We can't, I mean, other than knowing Yahweh is all in all and controlling all, prior to that, we didn't have a clue about this body and how it functioned, and that it is not by anything of our imagination. It's been totally proven to us through our Tuesday classes, going through the different systems, the 9 systems, just those alone, let alone talking about how Yahweh has set them up in triads and broke them down according to the pattern. You know, that was great to know. But no, he takes it further and get down to the minute things of how the system works without anyone saying anything, doing anything. It is spirit law. He is functioning. And that sometimes it just blows my mind and it puts me off into that shut your mouth. Because, you know, you can see Yahweh is running the whole show. It ain't been about you at all. When we were introduced to this teaching, given the foundation of what the blood, water, spirit 40, the death, burial, and resurrection, we were taught about the Jesus when we were born and as we was raised. But coming to this class, Dr. Kinley, having the divine vision perfectly planned out. I mean, I really don't know where to start. Because Yahweh had name was not revealed right away. That was according to purpose. That was according to plan. He had called Moses up into the mount. You know, he told Moses that what he wanted him to do is to go down and deliver his children. Nobody knew the name, but that was also according to purpose, also according to a plan. Just as with here in the garden with Adam. I've heard that people say, well, if I was Adam, I would have done that. No, the reason why you missed it is because it's all going according to an organized purpose, pattern, and plan. We supposed to have that in our daily life. And where did we get it from? He did it first. That's why we are to be organized and planning. But when we do our planning, I always keep that in mind. Hey, yes, I would like to. We do this if Yahweh's willing. That's always forefront. Because we have all experience in time that it can change. Something can come up. And that's a beautiful thing too. Because you didn't have nothing to do with it. And you just go with the flow. It's Yahweh's will. Accept what he has performed. And allowing us to be conscious of his attributal makeup manifesting not above the sun, moon, and stars, but right here. And it's telling us the story that we may recognize Yahshua. Manifesting, and why was this all done? He did it to save us, to bring us into the consciousness that, look, ain't nothing in existence but my son. That's what I can't. It's all about him. You be in him. You are. That's it. It ain't but one. Ain't one came down and one is leaving. It ain't gonna be a whole bunch of bodies. And to be in part of that body is peace. And he can elevate and will and has elevated us to know that's what we are. It's time for us, to me, this is, let me say for myself, to recognize that's who we are and to live that way. Not as, who was that Saul say? That he is not ashamed of the gospel. That is what we live. Put us out there, out in the world, you know. Look, I don't know what y'all would do. Because, see, barring is not my thing no more. Visiting is not my thing no more. You can pretty much just say, I don't have a life, but I'm okay. Because I found out it's not all of that. And that's not why I was put here. It was good while it lasted. It was a great teaching tool. And as we grow in the knowledge and understand, and believe me, we can sit here. That's why we come to class. It is Yahshua that reveals in and everything to us. It ain't about no man. It ain't about this one. It ain't about, no. You are a witness unto your own self that you hear, you see. And the only way that you can, the Holy Spirit had to do it. We don't do any of it. We can't take any credit at all. It is Him and Him only that is revealing. But so don't get hung up on the name. And think how blessed we are with the people out in the world. They don't even have the name right. You know, that is what makes us so special, that it was given to us. Yahweh's will. Be thankful, because we would have been just as blind, dumb, stupid, and ignorant, just like all the rest. And to see the things that they go through, and you just go, man, well, I want to do this, and I can't do this, and this is that is happening, and, you know, just getting all up in an uproar. Well, that's Yahweh's will. You know, take it down a notch. You ain't doing nothing, number one. That's where the problem lies. You know, I know my daughter probably just wanted to probably bop me upside the head sometimes. But see, I got this this grandson that wants to be a man. And he's still just starting out with his teens. But, you know, when you're in your little 14s and don't realize that when you get 16, you know, you're going to change. So what you're doing right now is not going to be the same in a couple of years. But, you know, often tell him, you know, hey, I've been where you are. And to try to use logic and say, well, why do you think Yahweh put me here first? So I can help you come through it. Everybody go through the same process. Your blood flow and function just like mine. The same thing is going through this life, this what we call life, walking through this flesh. We go through the same process. It may be a different manifestation, but it's the same thing. So, and you're going to get the same thing. Your experience is you're going to get knowledge. And from your knowledge, your intelligence, your wisdom, you know, all of that, it's coming. That's the track. But see, now we got our creator and maker to know, you know, how this is all coming about. Why? The one and only. You know, so there's, but with the grandson, it's really funny. You know, it's like, I'm at the point now, hey, I ain't got to worry about it. Yahweh will take care of it. And I don't mean it in a bad way. It's just keep, you know, my mom used to tell me, keep on living. And that will take care of it, because it's just a process. And they think they know, and I go, man. And even though I tell him, well, yeah, I know what Yahweh's name is. But no, we really got to get down and know. Not just his name. Like, it's constantly said, you know, like the scripture. Is it Matthew or John? Life eternal is to know. This is all that Dr. Kinley had and brought to us, is to know. and to learn about Yahweh's purpose, pattern, and plan, and that he brought his son down, that what he instituted, and he fulfilled it. He showed forth his father in it, and to know him, he will introduce you to his father. You know, that him, to know him, is eternal life, because who is he? Yes.
Let me read.
Oh, go ahead.
John 17:3. And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou art the true El and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
That's right. It's not three. It's not three individuals or entities. The one spirit. That thou art the true El and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent. Same spirit, just in a different, two different states. And that has been an important factor with us, is learning the name. And as Marlon brought out the other night about Elohim. Elohim is, it's not just Elohim, it's describing, you know, the eagle, the lion, the ox, the man. Yahweh has described himself so clearly that we can now take the yoke upon us and learn of him. That's it. You know, that is, and I'm finding, and it's beautiful. We have learned quite a bit, and I love it when I see how our class, it goes. You know, we have nothing really planned. We have the foundation and the format. And like the other day, Marlon say, well, I know we usually do this, but I want to hit on this over here and just see how it goes. Yeah, like y'all would take it. Using you, speak to you, that is direction it goes. And believe me, everybody enjoy it. Be something for everybody. Yahweh feeds the body what everybody needs. You know, we be full. Hey, even baby girl even brought some little goodies to show how well we eat. You know, I never tried it before, but it was good. Yeah. Yeah, so Yahweh does take care of us in maybe the smallest manners. And sometimes those are the things that I see and I appreciate. You know, it don't have to be no big whoop to do, but just the little. And they'll be like, wow. Because, and Dr. Kinley been running across my mind for quite a while saying, just take the time out, stop, and think logically, sensibly. You save yourself a lot of heartache. And I'll say those words in practicing, they give you peace. They give you peace, you know. And it's, it's a pleasure. Whether or not I'm a teacher, whether or not I'm just a student, whether or not I'm just here cleaning up, whether or not I'm here just to open the door, it does not matter. I'm just thankful that Yahweh has allowed me to be, to carry the grace. You know, because I recognize what he has given us. Eternal life is something, couldn't even imagine it. And we got more to learn. Ooh, we shouldn't have no complaints. But, you know, we still got this flesh. Now, that is a job, too. And I just finished going through a masterpiece of flesh. Thought I had it licked. And I had to finally, after tussling with it and knowing the destruction that it does for me, to me. But you know what? Yahweh said, I'm going to let you see. It ain't you that's going to take it away, because you done tried. And I honestly had to cry out and say, Yahshua, I cannot. I cannot do this. This flesh is too much. I cannot. It is. Look, I cannot whoop this one. I needed a savior. I need a savior. Mm-hmm. And I cried out, Father, deliver me. I cannot do this on my own. Next day, no problem. No problem. I hadn't been bothered with it. Because, see, you have to watch out how that satanic spirit, how that those thoughts come in. They will creep in there, will convince you. You knowing that it's wrong. But, oh, got so many justifications as to why it's right. And will convince me every freaking time. But I had to put on my big girl pants. And I had to stand up and say, not this time. I'm sorry. And he will keep coming, coming. No, 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 no. I had to battle that. But I start to feel humble and battling. You know? Because I know I couldn't do it. It was what was within me. Because on my own, couldn't. But Yahweh allowed me to see how my flesh, that I didn't recognize was my flesh, how flesh is a tough cookie. That's why we need saving. And that's why we're going through these things, and once we get through them, or we go through it and we see the value of it, we're taking that stuff off. We're taking it off. That's how we're going to be able to stand naked. What was it? We got as many concepts and opinions as many times as we have rehearsed this moderation. And all the things in the moderation, that's how many concepts and opinions and theories that stuff got to come off. And that is what's happening, because it was coming, everybody keeps saying, coming down to the close of the age. That's why we're going through this. Because we're getting rid of stuff. You're getting rid of stuff you don't even know that you're getting rid of. That's the beautiful part of it, too. Yahweh say, I'm working this work. And at the end of the day, Yahweh will get the glory for it. Because at one time, you know, now I'm sitting down talking to my daughter about, you know, hey, when I die, you know, this is the way I'm setting up the house. This is how I'm doing. You know, she's looking at me. Ain't nothing wrong. Look, you better do it now. You know, so what? You know, you do it every freaking night. So I'm trying to kick out that opinion, the concept, the scariness or whatever, you know? You know, we say we want to be in Yahweh. We want to, well, we got it. We got it. It's what you got on your mind, or what you think Yahweh is, or where you think Yahweh is. When he said, I'm the all in all and that's all. I mean, that's it. You, me, every. I'm sorry. That's who you are. And I can see the attributal makeups in each one of you guys. In fact, I got either it's right here or it's in one of my books. I got the attributes, those 9 attributes on the ones, the classmates here that I have seen manifested. Mm-hmm. And I go, wow, dude. That's, you know, I go, that's cold-blooded. But really, wisdom, knowledge, intelligence, beauty. Look, I mean, it's right here. So we can't miss Yahweh. Yeah. Okay, well, that's, it's not time for me to get off into, evidently, the things that be going through my head when I'm out, you know, alone and by myself. And I'm not going to try to force it. You know, that if Yahweh says this is where it is, where you go, there must be something left for me to learn. There's a lot for me to learn. And I'm not going to try to rush it. If he wants me to do it, it shall be done. You know, I cannot give up my opinion, my concept, but Yahweh definitely knows my heart. You know, and that is the truth that he has presented, you know, to us to learn about the death, burial, resurrection, about the transfiguration, about the creation. Got the creation right, because it was once said that years ago they had 2 counts of the creation. Well, it took Dr. Kinley that came in to tell me differently. There's only 1 count, because they're trying to say, you know, like in the first chapter of Genesis, and then in the second chapter, like there was 2 different versions. This is where it came from. And to eliminate the logical thinking, how did all of this information come down? Oh, well, it was passed down from Adam and all that. Come on. All of that was totally erroneous. We know now it makes sense that Yahweh is running his show. The people, the prophets, those that spoke back with Moses, Elijah, Isaiah, they have those names. Yahweh used those individuals. This is his show, his movie. He chose those vessels that he used and spoke to present what he had already planned for it to be carried out, because he brought forth the word. And that's what he manifested through these people's mouth, was his word. It went forth and it has not come back to him void. So it's so much as to the rhyme and reasons, you know, 70 elders, 3 trips in the mount, all pointing up to this one Yahshua that, even though the children, they had this carnal ordinances, but that was set up for a reason, and he knew they weren't going to keep it. But yet it's still to carry out his purpose, pattern, and plan, this whole movie. Then he gave them that law, but he also had his son that, really, it was instituted, and he also fulfilled it, took it to put it on the cross, nailed it to the cross. But like he said in Jeremiah, that he was going to make a new covenant. And this is where we can take a look at how it's being presented to us, is that after the death, burial, and resurrection, then that ended that physicalness for the Messiah. No longer was he in that physical body, but he didn't die. He didn't go nowhere. He just changed clothes. And Yahweh, knowing that we cannot perceive of that, he had Dr. Kinley came in to give us the full story, teaches us how to go about lining it up to be able to see the repetitions of it, to know that it's true, that we can believe what the prophets have written, and that when in Jeremiah, when he said that he was going to make a new covenant, not with the house of Israel and Judah, but this covenant that he was going to do right in our hearts and in our minds. So we, this is gone. We've crossed over into a new day. It's in our hearts and mind. Why is it so that we recognize the truth? Because everybody don't recognize and accept the truth. So what makes it so that we can accept it and recognize it? Because it's in our hearts and in our minds. And we got to be woken up to what is there, where it is. Let me sit down, because I can just rattle, because like I say, things just be popping off in my head, and I think I can probably, I like doing maybe regular conversations with people, but you know, I don't think I'm a speaker per se. So, but I thank Yahweh for allowing me the time to express my gratitude.
Testing. Thank you, Dr. Reiser. I'll be the next speaker for today's class. I appreciated the remarks from Dr. Reiser. She set a good foundation, and she talked about some things that were on my heart and mind. And I did enjoy the scripture lesson as well. I picked that scripture lesson because it resonated with me. For the simple fact that it's something in the so-called Old Testament that talks about what needs to happen in order for that spirit of righteousness to come into your heart and mind. You know, they were under, in those days, law of carnal ordinances, fleshly law. You know, when they made a mistake, when they broke one of those laws, they had to sacrifice and offer up a sacrifice and atonement at this physical structure, which was like their king. But it's a type and shadow of Yahweh Elohim being made manifest, who's really sitting on that throne of this tabernacle that's making an atonement for all of the things that
we go through, like the previous speaker was talking about. She prayed, she gave a prayer to Yahweh to take away, you know, any confusion and things from her. And next thing you know, she's not worried about it no more, you know. And Dr. Kinley, in 1931, had a divine vision and revelation from our Heavenly Father himself, whose name is Yahweh, which before coming into this school and understanding this doctrine, we really don't know how important that name is.
That's right.
And why it's important. And what we're coming down here to do is to learn. And when one gets on the floor to speak at one of these lectures, I'll speak for myself and say, I don't want to be the speaker. I don't want Sean coming into the mix. Unless I'm using Sean to expose where I came from. I want to express to those who are seeking to know who their Heavenly Father is, who Yahweh Elohim is, I want to teach something that somebody can use to investigate and prove that what's being taught at this school is good. And the previous chapter, if you can get that there, in Ecclesiastes, the sixth chapter, was really what started my desire to read seven. But six is short. So I'd like to have you read the sixth chapter. It's like 12 verses or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then we'll go on from there, and we'll pick it up with the seven and see if we can make something happen here.
6:1. Mm-hmm. There is an evil which I have seen under the sun, and it is common among men. A man to whom Elohim has given riches, wealth, and honor, so that he wanteth nothing for his soul of all that he desireth. Yet Elohim giveth him not power to eat thereof, but a stranger eateth it. This is vanity, and it is an evil disease. Mm-hmm. If a man beget 100 children and live many years, so that the days of his years be many, and his soul be not filled with good, and also that he have no burial, I say that an untimely birth is better than he. For he cometh in with vanity and departeth in darkness, and his name shall be covered with darkness. Moreover, he hath not seen the sun, nor known anything. This hath more rest than the other. Yea, though he live 1,000 years twice told, yet hath he seen no good. Do not all go to one place? All the labor of man is for his mouth, and yet the appetite is not filled. For what hath the wise more than the fool? What hath the poor that knoweth to walk before the living? Better is the sight of the eyes than the wandering of the desire. Mm-hmm. This is also vanity and vexation of spirit.
That's right.
That which has been is named already, and it is known that it is man. Neither may be content with man that is mightier than he. Seeing there be many things that increase vanity, what is man the better? For who knoweth what is good for man in this life, all the days of his vain life, which he spendeth as a shadow? For who can tell a man what shall be after him under the sun?
Thank you. So, I mean, that was short, but it goes right along with the next chapter there. It's almost, chapter 6 and chapter 7 is almost a complete thought. So I wanted to have that read because we're here to learn. And thinking about this vanity, we're steeped in that before you come into one of these schools and don't even know it. Mm-hmm. To be honest, just going to talk about Sean for a second. I thought vanity was being conceited. I didn't even have any idea before coming into this school that vanity could mean useless, meaningless, worthless, futile. And Yahweh does not want his son, he will not allow his son to walk in vanity. That's why he set up a school, so that his son, his only begotten son, because it ain't but one, can come to know something about his father. And I say that because I want to say this, that there is no you in Yahweh. There are billions of people that walk the face of the earth, whether they know Yahweh or whether they don't know Yahweh, they are all made up of Yahweh.
Right.
Yahweh is spirit, as we say in the moderation. He is pure spirit. In being pure, he is eternal in everything that he is. And matter, which is what makes us up, is spirit materialized. Those attributes that Dr. Reiser was talking about of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, wrapped up in the kingdom, make up the matter that we know and understand. There are more attributes, but these are the principal attributes. Thank you, Dr. Salas. And we don't want to be ignorant of where we come from and who we really are, because we come into the world and we have those five finite senses of sight, touch, taste, sound, and smell. And we can't comprehend spirit without it being revealed to us. So you grow and you think you got agility because you can play football or you're a good dancer. You think you got strength because you can ride a bike really fast or lift heavy weights. You think you're keen because your eyesight is 20/20 and you can spot
right.
Minute movements from a far distance away, or you can fire a rifle and shoot moving targets, and you think those things make up your greatness. Yeah. And you know, here in this it's either the scripture lesson or, Let me see where it's at right here. There was one thing that was talked about where 7 and 15. Read Ecclesiastes 7 and 15, please.
7 and 15.
Yes.
All things have I seen in the days of my vanity.
Now, before you come into this school, you got experiences. Some more than others. Some live a sheltered life and live routines and structured schedules, and everything is planned out for them, you know, from their birth all the way up to their adulthood, and they, you know, settle into careers, and, you know, everything's pretty much, you know, set up. Other people don't have that structure in their life, and they're here, and they're there, and they're all over the place, and they're exploring, and they're wandering, and they want to know, you know, whatever it is, because nobody gave them a direction, so they got to find their own way.
Yeah.
Some people are afraid of the world because they have some bad experiences, and they're scared, so they keep themselves locked, you know, hidden, and they don't want to experience things because they expect fear. They expect pain, and you know who wants to get hit? Yeah. You know, most of the time, you know, unless you're a fighter, you know, some people like to get hit. But nevertheless, all things have I seen in the days of my vanity. You in vanity, before knowing anything of who Yahweh is and how he actually exists, you've seen all of these things. We'll go ahead and read.
There is a just man that perisheth in his righteousness.
There's a just man that perishes, that dies in his righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
He dies in his righteousness. Now, there's another scripture that says, for Yahweh so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son.
Right.
And when he gave his only begotten son, he sent him down there, he brought him, walked the earth plane, and he let it, gave him to die. He perished. Physically so. Died the death of an outcast dog. A spectacle for everyone around who wanted to see, to come in and view it. And that, in righteousness, was perishing. And what we want you to know is that you got to do the same thing. But we're not asking you to get up on a cross,
right,
and, you know, get stabbed and,
yeah,
you know, crown of thorns, nails in your hands. You ain't got to do that. You got to die in, you got, the flesh has to come off. Your carnal mind, your theories, concepts, and opinions, and thoughts about who you think you are has to come off. And you must realize that you are Yahweh. You must die out of Sean, speaking for myself.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua has to come into my heart and my mind. That old covenant has been fulfilled. We have to recognize that. Understand what that means. What's the scripture that says, take on my yoke and learn of me? What was that, Matthew 12? Mm-hmm. 11 and 12. Can you read that? Excuse me.
Matthew 11 and 28.
Yeah, come unto me.
"Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden." And
come unto, this is Yahshua speaking, saying, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden." You out here trying to find God, trying to make sure that you going to heaven. That's funny.
That is funny.
Because it's funny because there's a certain level of confusion in the desire to want to go to heaven. You come down to this school and you'll find out that you already are in heaven. But nevertheless, read.
"And I will give you rest."
He will give you rest. Read.
"Take my yoke upon you and learn of me."
Take my yoke upon you. A yoke is like something that an oxen will wear, like around their neck, like, you know, that when they're plowing the field and whatnot, so that the gardens, you know, all of the seeds can be planted, whatever, for the harvest coming. So they got the yoke and they pull it, and that's their burden. Now he's saying, "Take my yoke." What is his yoke? Read.
"For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls."
You find rest unto your soul by taking his yoke upon you. Now, and he's going to tell you what his yoke is here. Read.
"For my yoke is easy and my burden is light."
Right. Read.
12. "At that time, Yahshua went on the Sabbath day through the wheat field, and his disciples..."
Did I miss it? Did I take my yoke upon you and you're learning me? I missed it. Go. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Read that part again where it says, "Take my yoke upon me and learning me." I blanked out for a second, I guess.
This is Matthew 11:29.
Mm-hmm.
"Take my yoke upon you and learn of me."
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. That's what I wanted. His yoke is to learn of him. Now, what is that where he says, "They are they which testify of me"? You search the scriptures. Because Yahshua is telling his disciples, actually, to learn of him.
5:39?
Yeah.
John 5:39.
And so we need to know who this is that, we need to learn about. Go ahead and read that right there.
John 5:39.
Mm-hmm.
"You search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life."
You search the scriptures, for in them, in the scriptures, in what you got in your book from Genesis over to Malachi. Because at the time that this was being said, there was no Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
Right.
Or the Acts of the Apostles or Romans or anything in the so-called New Testament, which is not actually the New Testament.
Right.
Because the New Testament is not written on the other side of a fly leaf in a book. Right. And it's written in a book that is not written in pen and ink.
Right.
But it'll be written in your heart and in your mind. Mm-hmm. But go ahead and talk about, read.
"And they are they which testify of me."
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they're they which testify of me.
Right.
That's Yahshua the Messiah speaking. Mm-hmm. So he's telling you over there in the last thing that we read, learn of me.
Right.
And he's telling you right over here in John, you search the scriptures, and they're that would testify of me. So we got some work to do. Some reading. You read through the scriptures. You do an investigation. You study. That's why we're out of school.
Right.
And what Yahweh has done, he has revealed a pattern by which man and everything in the universe is made and operates so that we can, in our investigation, in our research, in reading the scriptures, we can correlate those things to this pattern. And we can know that we can know something. We can know something about spirit. Because you could take this law. And you can read how if the children of Israel were to follow this law and complete this law in its entirety, then it would be unto their righteousness. Mm-hmm. And then you can read and see that nobody could do it. And then you can continue on to read and see that Yahshua the Messiah did. He fulfilled and completed this law in its entirety to put this law to an end, mm-hmm. not destroy it.
Right.
He didn't want to give it to the 517 there. He didn't want to destroy it because we can use it.
Right.
See, Dr. Kinley, the founder of this school, in 1931, when he had this divine vision and revelation, he had a panoramic vision. He's seen all the way around. He's seen the purpose of Yahweh and the pattern of Yahweh and the plan of Yahweh's salvation. Right there at his house in Springfield, Ohio. All in one fell swoop. And he had the vision. Then he had the revelation, which gave him the understanding of what he's seen. And he went on, after Yahweh asked him what he would do with what he was shown, he said, teach your people. Mm-hmm. And he endeavored for the rest of his life here on earth in a physical body to incorporate, set up a school, set up a curriculum, and teach the people who wanted to know something about their Heavenly Father, who He is. And the reason why I said that is because he got it all in one fell swoop. But each and every one of us who have come under the sound of this doctrine get it in piecemeal.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We hold that 5 and 17. Get us, whom shall he teach knowledge? What is that? Whom shall he teach knowledge and whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Isaiah. Yeah. Is that 8 and 20? I'm so not good at calling scriptures. I know what I want.
Isaiah 28 and 9.
Isaiah 28.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm ready.
Whom shall he teach knowledge, mm-hmm. and whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
We want some knowledge. We want some knowledge. Because Yahshua said, my burden is light. And he said, learn of him. We want that knowledge. Because if you're heavy laden,
yeah,
you want that rest in your soul, don't you? So you want that knowledge. So we want to find out how you get that knowledge. Go ahead.
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Mm-hmm. Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast.
Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. Milk is made up of the basic nutrition, the nutritional values, the principal nutrients that a physical body needs. That's the principle of milk. A physical body, a baby cannot ingest the meats and the breads and all of the different things like that. But it can take that milk. And when you come into this school, and you never been to this thing before, you come from whatever secular background that you have, or atheist, if you will, you don't know nothing about Yahweh. And somebody, I'm just going to speak for myself. People will get up here that go through the moderation over and over and over again. I just learned, I've been in this school 20 years, just learned the moderation in the last couple of years and got it memorized and understand it. You hear it every time you come to class. We hold classes 3 days a week. But you hear it over and over and over again. Yet, unless Yahweh reveals that right to you, you're not going to understand it. You go through, we keep these things, our classes, basic. We talk about Moses. You have to begin at Moses. Mm-hmm. People come to class so long they don't want to come anymore. I'm tired of hearing about Moses. Mm-hmm. But can you get up here and tell me about Moses? You know?
Yeah.
just the previous speaker was talking about The two accounts of the beginning of the creation in Genesis, the first chapter, and Genesis, the second chapter. Do you know why that is? I can tell you why it is. I can explain it. I would like to break it down. But you see, it took me coming to this school and hearing a teacher get up on this floor and explain. Right. The basic principles of these of this doctrine over and over and over and over again. And not try to get too far in depth and abstract with it, but just keeping it simple. And those simple things are the milk, the blood, the water, the spirit. Just understanding what the blood represents and the water represents and the spirit represents, it's like take almost a college education.
You're right. Yeah.
But you don't have to have a college education. Right. Dr. Kinley, the founder of this school, he had a sixth grade education. And went on to institute a school that would confound the Pope. He'll poo-poo this school faster than he can get to his Pope-mobile because he just doesn't have any understanding of this. When people don't have an understanding, they make excuses, they dismiss, so on and so forth. Many people that I've invited to this school, they just dismiss it. In the moderation, we say this. In this school, we show proof. That's a very strong statement. That we are showing, it's a profound statement. We show proof. how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this tabernacle that Yahweh gave so that we can know something about right. who he is and how he actually exists. Yeah. You know, this is a physical structure that explains spiritual things. Mm-hmm. That's what we have here. And this isn't a construct of something that Henry Clifford Kinley came up with.
Right.
You can go in history books and find this.
That's right.
And this dates way back before Henry Clifford Kinley's great-grandfather was around. It wasn't a passed down a tradition, generation to generation, little secret, you know, underground railroad type thing or nothing like that, because he was a black man. No. No. This is out straight out the book.
That's right.
You can go in your book right now for whatever Christian religion that you subscribe to. If you read the Bible and, you know, you're not a New Testament Christian
yeah.
and you read the old book and read in Exodus, you will see a description of this tabernacle pattern. And it is said to see that everything is made after the structure and function of this tabernacle pattern. Mm-hmm. Now, over in where we're at, read. Go ahead.
10.
Yeah.
Isaiah 28:10.
Mm-hmm.
For precept must be upon precept.
Yes.
Precept upon precept.
Right.
Line upon line.
Mm-hmm.
Line upon line.
Mm-hmm.
Here a little and there a little.
That's right.
For with stammering lips and another tongue will I speak to this people.
Right.
To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest.
Woo! Now we just read over there where he said, learn of me.
Yeah.
And I will give rest unto your soul. Now we just come down to this school and we talk about Moses. And it just mentioned with stammering lips and another tongue. Let me tell you where your Bible came from. And it wasn't passed down from Adam. It was written as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to Moses.
Right.
Not Henry Clifford Kinley, but Moses.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people, when they hear this man, Henry Clifford Kinley, said he had a vision and revelation, they think he was hallucinating. They think he might have been on peyote or something. Or, you know, you just wacky. You having visions and revelations.
Yeah.
That's to somebody who's never seen anything, that's just
far-fetched.
Look,
yeah.
John 1 and 3 or 4, where it talks about that darkness, because we talk about that darkness and we talk, and I want to get back over to Ecclesiastes, but I want to make this point. I'm trying to draw this out.
The light shine in darkness?
Yeah.
Okay. John 1 and 4.
You're going to start at 3.
3.
Mm-hmm.
All things were made by him, and without
just,
him
just
was
pick it up at 1.
1. In the beginning was the Word.
In the beginning was the Word. And that's not a book.
Right.
The Word is Yahweh Elohim.
Right.
That is Yahweh putting on his working clothes,
mm-hmm.
taking on shape and form right within himself, taking action. That is the Word. In the beginning of this creation was the Word. Read.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
And that Word was Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't take all of Yahweh to make Yahweh Elohim. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by him.
All things that were created. And we, no exception, everybody in this room and everybody who will ever look at this video, if you ever do, has been created. You are of the creation. So we talking about you. Read.
All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
You too. Read.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
In him, the word.
Right.
Which was with Yahweh and was Yahweh.
Right.
So Yahweh is the word, and in the word was life. Mm-hmm. And that life was the light. Well, go ahead and read it.
In him was life, mm-hmm. and the life was the light of men.
And the life was the light of men, the illumination of your physical body is derived from the word. Mm-hmm. You, me, the dogs running down the street, the cats, the rats, the roaches, the fish.
So.
The earth, the planets, the suns, the asteroids, the comets. The atoms, everything that has life, every bit of energy mm-hmm. that is taking on action is that spirit being materialized, that spirit of the word. In the beginning was the word. Read.
5. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
All right. Go back to Ecclesiastes and 15. 7 and 15.
Yeah. Ecclesiastes 7:15.
Mm-hmm.
All things have I seen in the days of my vanity.
Mm-hmm.
There is a just man that perisheth in his righteousness.
Right.
And there is a wicked man that prolongeth his life in his wickedness.
Now, let me tell you, that wicked man works hard, is focused, he gets a good job. Marries a woman and doesn't cheat on her. Has offspring and kids. Builds a house. Sets up a trust fund for them kids. Puts them kids through school and gets them education. Make sure that they get a job and help them along the way. Buy them a car when they get their driver's license. Takes them back and forth to the hospital when they get sick. Walks them down the aisle or is there present for their weddings. Helps them get that loan to buy their first house. Grows old. Gives his grandchildren Werther's originals and tells them stories mm-hmm. about everything that he's done growing up through his life and all the things that he has done to pave a way for them in hopes that them little ones remember him. I'm sorry, that was loud. In hopes that them little ones remember him and he leaves and he can leave behind a legacy. whatever he's built. He knows his flesh got to come off. He knows that one day he's got a date with death. He don't know what's going to happen after that date with death. But all he does know is he want to make sure that everything that he put together, people remember it. Mm. Prolonging that life. giving no credit to Yahweh for giving him everything that he has. Everything that he's enjoyed. Everything that he built. Mm-hmm. Not giving praise to that word, which is spirit, materialized, which made it all possible.
That's right.
Now, when you have some wisdom, when Yahweh reveals himself to you, I almost said it, none of this matters. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You can have it.
Yeah.
You can't take it with you anyways. You realize you can't take it with you, and there's something greater than any of this. I was just talking to Eunice just yesterday, and I was talking about cars. You know, the cars on going around a racetrack. A lot of times, people will give credit to the car for winning the race. But that car, it can have all of the torque. It can have the best tires on it. It can have, you know, the good transmission gear ratios and everything like that. But without a suitable driver to operate it, it's no good. That's the same thing with these physical bodies that we have. You can lift weights. You know, you could be the fairest of all the maidens in the land. Ain't nobody going to want you if you're laying dead there on the floor. You're not, and you don't have that animation. You don't have that soul in you. You're gonna start stinking. The bugs will want you. The insects and where you'll decompose. But, you know, This is the spirit that's within you, that soul that was within the man that makes you up. And if you don't know who you are and how you actually exist, then you're in darkness. Mm-hmm. You can't comprehend that you are Yahweh. You need some help. That's why I say you can come down to this class and you can hear what these people say, what the teachers say, and not understand it.
Yeah.
Well, Romans 1:19 and 20.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Because that which may be known from Yahweh of Yahweh is manifest in them. Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
For Yahweh showed it unto them. I could get up here. Let's say it. I could get up here and I could talk until I'm blue in the face. I'm not teaching you nothing. Even if everything that I say up here is the truth.
Yeah.
I can't make you understand it.
That's right.
The only one that can allow you to understand it is Yahweh himself. So if you want to learn of him, and there's something that you can know about him, you got to ask him. And you got to ask him in sincerity. Yahweh knows your heart and mind because you derive from him.
That's right.
You can flip your collar up inside out and get your posture all correct and articulate your verbs and pronouns as much as you like. You can pontificate all you want. That's true. into destruction.
Yeah.
You can learn the ways of the world and preach prosperity and donate to the homeless and cure diseases. But without Yahweh, it ain't no good.
True.
Go ahead and keep reading over there in Romans.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
That's what we're talking about. The invisible things. So that word taking on shape and form. How are you going to see it if you can't see spirit? He gave us something right here. This tabernacle pattern, so that you can understand the invisible things of the creation of the world. They're clearly seen. Read.
Being understood by the things that are made.
Being understood by the things that are made. Read.
Even his eternal power.
Even his eternal power.
And supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Eternal power. You know, eternal don't got no beginning and no ending. And you can understand that. You can see it. And we say we show proof that everything in the universe is made according to this structure and function right here. That's eternal. Everything. Nothing escapes it. It's eternal. Now, Yahweh revealed, he has to reveal himself. Just like he revealed himself to Moses. And you have to understand how Yahweh is going to communicate with you. And you have to accept how Yahweh is going to communicate with you. And if you want to learn of his son.
Yeah.
If you want to be a part of the family, you got to follow the rules. The third aim of this school is to investigate the unexplained spirit law. It's unexplained because you didn't know nothing about it before you came in. We explaining it down here.
Yeah.
To it, but if you don't do the investigation, it remains unexplained to you. I can explain it all day long. I can understand it all day long. I can understand it. I can have a profound understanding of it. What good is that going to do you?
Right.
If you don't understand it, it's still unexplained. We just read over there, that which may be known to Yahweh is manifested in them because Yahweh showed it to him.
Right.
You better ask Yah. I would advise you to ask Yahweh.
Right.
You could do what you want to do.
Mm-hmm. True that.
You can seek the truth, or you can make up your mind that you like it the way you think it is. You know? We got one spirit in operation here. That's the truth. Yet there are two mysteries.
Mm-hmm.
That mystery of righteousness and the mystery of iniquity. You think that this flesh is something? You go ahead and park that car out there long enough in the outside and go back to it and try to start it up. Battery dead. Bushings all worn out.
Mm-hmm.
Fluids all coagulated and dried up. And it doesn't even have the ability. You got to do a restoration to get life back to it.
That's right. Yeah.
Same thing with this physical body. You got to take care of it. You got to preen it, prune it, wash it,
yeah.
Feed it. All these different things to keep it up and going. Mm-hmm. And it's still got a date with death.
Yeah, I do still. Yeah. Hmm.
Now, Moses was born down here in Egypt under a death decree. And he was born after a promise was made to Abraham that through his seed, would his seed would inherit this Canaan land here after it was evilly entreated 400 years in a land it knew not of. And his seed did go down into Egypt and was down there 400 years. And Moses was of the lineage of Abraham. And him being born under that death decree, he had to remain hidden. Because if the Egyptians would have found out about him, they would have killed him, surely.
Yeah.
And his mother, who loved him, hid him. And when she could no longer hide him, she fabricated a little ark and placed it in the bulrushes and the flags of the brink of the River Nile. So he wasn't floating on down, row, row, row your boat gently. Now, you heard that before.
Yeah.
Merrily, merrily, you heard that. No, he wasn't floating on down like they show in the movies or in the cartoons. He was off to the side, hidden in a quiet place near where Pharaoh's daughter went to bathe. Pharaoh's daughter heard that baby crying and sent one of her servants out to fetch that baby and say, well, why is that baby out there in the bushes out there in the water? Is something going to happen? It's going to roll out. Go get that baby. See what that. And Pharaoh's daughter had mercy on that child. She knew that it was a Hebrew child because it was circumcised. Because that was an ordinance that Yahweh had given. Mm-hmm. That the Hebrew children must be circumcised.
Right.
This was already preordained. It was already set up. And we can understand the invisible things by the things that are made, because he drew it out meticulously, unerringly, so that there can be no mistake as to who did this.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And Pharaoh's daughter told that handmaiden to find somebody to nurse that child, and Moses went back, reunited with his mother, and was brought up around his own brethren. So he knew who his family was. And then when he was weaned, he came and was raised up in Pharaoh's household as like unto a king.
Mm-hmm.
A prince, if you will. Excuse me. And it came when he was 40 years old. He was out among his brethren and seen an Egyptian persecuting one of his brethren. And he slayed that Egyptian. And he hid that Egyptian. And that Egyptian had to be important. Because him growing up as a prince, he had authority over the land. When it was found out that people knew, other than his brother, that he saved from the Egyptian who was persecuting him, when it was found out that other people knew, Moses knew in his conscience that it was going to be found out. So he fled out of that land of Egypt for his life into the wilderness of Sinai. And he met a woman. And married that woman. And tended to that woman's father's flock of sheep. So that that woman did not have to go out there and do that and deal with the man,
mm-hmm.
shepherds. He protected that woman. And in while he was out tending to his father-in-law's flock of sheep, he came to the base of the Mount Sinai. And Yahweh Elohim appeared to him in a vision at a bush, as a bush that was burning but not being consumed. And Moses recognized that this is something special. And he turned aside in his consciousness to try to comprehend what he was seeing. And Yahweh, seeing that he turned in his consciousness, and he said, Moses, here am I. Mm-hmm. And he revealed himself to Moses right there at that burning bush. And he commissioned Moses at this time. We don't got time to read it, but we're talking about Exodus, the third chapter right now, to go back down here into Egypt and bring the Hebrews, the Israelites, out of this bondage, out of the land, to the Mount Sinai, to worship Yahweh, who put them down there in the first place, and is bringing them out now, according to the promise that was given to his forefather, Abraham. And he showed Moses miracles. And Moses was still afraid. And Moses had a speech impediment. So Yahweh said, your brother Aaron's down there and he's going to meet you. Mm-hmm. And Aaron will do the talking. You just go down there and do the action. Mm-hmm. And that's what we got over here. In Isaiah, with stammering lips and another tongue, I'll speak to my people. Mm-hmm. You're not going to learn that nowhere in no church. I ain't never heard nothing about it nowhere in no church, nowhere.
Yep.
Now, 10 devastating plagues were poured out on those Egyptians before Pharaoh would let those Israelites go. And he still would, even after they spoiled the Egyptians, got all of their raiment, gathered up all of their everything that they could carry and take with them, and were making their way on out of Egypt to the Red Sea, Pharaoh's heart was hardened yet once more. Pharaoh represents that mystery of iniquity, lusting after that flesh. How dare this Moses come down here and take away my kingdom, my servants, all of the people that are here to build my treasure cities and everything? I'm going to take these fools out. He gathers his chariots. He said, I'm sick of these fools. I got to do it. I'm going to have to do it myself. He get on one of them chariots. And he go after him. Meet him at the Red Sea here. Yahweh parts this Red Sea and allows the children of Israel to go through on dry ground. Those Egyptians follow. Yahweh caused that Red Sea to swallow those Egyptians up. They're not allowed up here. And that kills off Pharaoh. He dies at that point in time. No more Pharaoh. And this represents the court roundabout of this tabernacle down here in Egypt. And this Red Sea represents the door to the holy place. And it also represents the brazen laver. This journey in its totality, because we pressed for time, each step that those children of Israel made from Egypt all the way up into Canaan land represents the structure and function of this tabernacle. Now, when these children of Israel were out here in this wilderness, They were told to prepare themselves because Yahweh was going to speak to them. And Moses was called up into this mount three times. And the first time that Moses was called up into the mount, he was given the Ten Commandment law. And that's when we was told not to take his name, the Yahweh's name, in vain. Make it useless. We're talking about vanity over here, right, in Ecclesiastes a lot. Yahweh don't want anything according that his children to be in vain. Because Yahweh is righteousness and truth. Yahweh in righteousness is truth. His son is the truth. Now, he was given that Ten Commandment law that first trip up. The second trip, Moses was given a vision of the creation in six solar days. And that's where you got Genesis 1 and 1. That's where Genesis 1 and 1 comes from. It doesn't come from Adam, passed on down, generation, like grandpa with the Werther's Originals telling the story. Oh, yeah. No, that's that prolonging of his life in wickedness that we reading about over in Ecclesiastes 7 and 15, when people try to purport that this thing was passed down from man all the way down, and denying the fact that Yahweh appeared to Moses in a vision.
Right.
Taking away the power of Yahweh to reveal himself. Mm-hmm. And when you go back over to, I'm almost out of time. When you go back over to Exodus, the third chapter, when Moses asked Yahweh what his name was, he said, Ayah, Asher, Ayah. Which translates, I will be what I will to be. So this means that he has the ability to reveal himself to whom he chooses, and he has the ability to hide himself from who he pleases.
Yep. True that.
And then he said, moreover, his name is Yahweh, which is masculine and feminine right within himself. One who causes to exist that which exists. He has no reason or no need, excuse me, to go outside of himself to create anything. Therefore, he has the ability to take on shape and form right within himself as Yahweh Elohim. Hence, what you have in the beginning of John's vision being the Word. And in that second trip in the mount, he's seen all the way up to Adam and Eve in bliss in the garden. And then Yahweh rested. And for the next 33 and a half days, showed him that tabernacle pattern. And we can't get into detail because we're out of time. But in that third trip, what happened when he came down necessitated him to go back up into the mount again, because he didn't see it all the second time he went up there. And on that third trip, he got a recapitulation of what he's seen in the first trip, and all the way down to enough information to write the first five books of what you have in your Bible, the Pentateuch. So you have your first account of Moses' vision in Genesis 1 and 1. And then you have your second account of Moses' vision at Mount Sinai in Genesis 2. And this school was created as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder. The book of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and the book of Revelation was written as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to John on the Isle of Patmos. Come to class and learn what you can, what Yahweh will reveal to you about who he is and how he actually exists. I hope that something was got out of what was said today that will conclude today's lecture. Hallelujah. Thank you. The conference, symposium, what have you, is current. It has started today in Northside, Chicago. You can view it on the Northside Chicago YouTube channel. You can subscribe to that for more videos, but you can look at all the things that are they're having, all the sessions that they're having. It started today. It ends on Sunday. So we would like to encourage the brethren to view it. And our hearts and minds are with the brethren out there. We hope everybody who traveled out there made it safe and everybody makes it home safe and, you know, everything goes well. And we're glad that, you know, that is underway, and we're going to enjoy that. Dr. Love is visiting Chicago there. He's present out there with them. So we hope you're enjoying yourself as well, too. We can't wait for you to get back and tell us what you got from it. Do we have any other announcements? Okay. So as I'm the moderator, we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truthfully the place to learn something about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Any and all donations can be had by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now, and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Do that.
Why did we do that?
Well, I just